Prof, thank you for your time. Really, we want the ABCs. Take us to school, Prof. What is sub judice, and at what point does it come up as a conversation?
Yes, so traditionally, the sub judice rule says that you cannot say or do anything during the process that the trial happens that is likely going to influence the outcome of the trial. So once the court process starts, you cannot make arguments about this person lying, that person, and so on. In South Africa, the sub judice rule has really been, to a large extent, abolished because the Supreme Court of Appeal said that it doesn't apply anymore because it used to be a rule that protected the courts in a jury system where 12 ordinary people from the street have to hear the evidence and then they have to decide and they could be easily persuaded. We have judges, they're not going to be easily persuaded. So the only time there's a sub judice rule still applies in the South African context is if you say something that would pose a real risk to the fairness of the trial. So if you threaten to kill the judge, if you run a Twitter campaign in which you denigrate all the witnesses, maybe that would be sub judice, but that would be extreme cases. In most cases now in South Africa, we can comment on any court proceedings and it's never going to be found to be sub judice.
And just to backtrack for a moment then, Prof, let me ask you to just explain the basics, the Latin of it all, sub judice. Where does it come from and what does it mean?
Yes, so I don't know much about Latin, although I did it at university. But the principle is really that something has not yet been decided. It's before a decision of the court is taken, say in a criminal trial, are you guilty, are you not guilty? So everything that happens before the verdict comes in is sub judice, before judgment. And so the argument was that you are not allowed to say anything about the trial because it could potentially influence that verdict that is going to happen when the court finally makes a decision.
And interestingly, throughout our conversation over the last few minutes, you keep referring to, you know, a court and a trial. I've not heard you saying anything about this matter is before the police for investigation and therefore you are likely to prejudice the outcome of the trial. Does it apply when a matter is before police for investigation with the result that it may or may not lead to charges being proffered by the NPA?
Well, it almost certainly didn't apply before the Supreme Court of Appeal watered down the rule. It definitely doesn't apply now because the rule says there needs to be at least a court process. The process doesn't start when the actual trial starts, but say in a criminal trial, the day that you are charged, you are arrested and charged, then the rule normally would kick in, of course, given the qualification is that it really only applies if you say or do something that has a real possibility of influencing the outcome of the trial.
So with the backdrop that you've just painted for us, Prof, when you hear members of parliament, lawmakers, the people we entrust as citizens, once every 5 years we queue to elect our representatives as part of our democratic system, when you hear them saying we as a committee of parliament can't discuss an issue that, you know, ordinarily would serve before us simply because you know, someone has gone and laid a charge and therefore we can wash our hands off it. What goes through your mind?
Well, firstly, one has to clarify that the rules of parliament actually provides for the sub judice rule and says members of parliament in discussions in parliament cannot discuss matters before the court because the matter would be sub judice. But even that rule doesn't apply before there's actually a court case. So if, like in this case, people say, well, there might be an investigation, there might be criminal proceedings, there might be something else, they are really abusing even the existing rules, the parliamentary rule, which is almost certainly unconstitutional because it's in conflict with the Supreme Court of Appeal judgment on sub judice. But even if we assume it's not unconstitutional, that rule is not applicable in this case. So we know that politicians, powerful people, often abuse the sub judice rule to avoid being held accountable. And for me, that is exactly what has happened here. The members of parliament are protecting the minister, and the way they are doing so is by invoking really a version of the sub judice rule that does not exist and that is not provided for in the very rules of parliament.
Because you are a teacher of the law, I imagine that you are used to having to repeat issues ad infinitum. This whole issue around the role of parliament and holding the executive to account, please remind the members of parliament that actually we've dealt with this issue. It was that judgment in Nkandla as well as the judgment of the UDM. My suspicion is that if they continue along this track, few years down the line, in fact, few months or few years down the line, they'll be crying judicial dictatorship when the judiciary has to remind them that actually this is your job.
Yes, so obviously the problem here is a big one because there's a gap between what the Constitution requires members of Parliament to do and what they actually do. There was a few weeks of the Zondo Commission of Inquiry into State Capture where this issue was exactly explored and it was shown that the failure of the members of parliament to hold the executive accountable, which they are constitutionally not only permitted to do, but required to do, was facilitated the state capture. And so it is really not in the interest of parliament and of the democracy for members of parliament not to fulfill their constitutional obligations. And the Constitutional Court made it very clear. It said, you have to do this. And the court has actually ordered the parliament case of the impeachment of the president to take steps to hold the executive and the president accountable. And they did so because parliament had failed to do it, and it has been widely admitted before the Zondo Commission and elsewhere that there was such a failure.
Lastly, Prof, let's take advantage of the fact that I have you here. Another myth that you have bust previously is the myth around I have a right to be presumed innocent until proven guilty. It is a right that does exist, but it has a specific context. For the benefit of all the politicians, the parliamentarians and others outside of parliament, does that right to be presumed innocent until proven guilty bind me as a citizen watching what politicians are doing all the time? Do I have a duty to presume them innocent until proven guilty?
Well, the Constitutional Court said the constitutional right to be presumed innocent is a right that is enjoyed by an accused person who stands before the court and to be presumed innocent by that court. There's no right, a general constitutional right, to be presumed innocent by the public at large. Of course, if you are going to call somebody criminal or corrupt or whatever, if it's not true or if it's not fair comment, you might be exposing yourself to defamation. But that is different from you're not breaching the right of the accused person to be presumed innocent, because that right is respected, because the court who's going to hear the case, the judges, are going to make sure that they presume the accused person to be innocent. That does not apply to ordinary people. But at the same time, making wild allegations against anyone, including a politician, that you wouldn't be able to back up if you are sued for defamation is obviously not a wise thing to do. But if there's evidence, if you express an opinion based on the actual evidence, then you're perfectly entitled to do so, and the right to be presumed innocent is not binding on you.
Professor DeVos, thank you for your time. By the way, do you still get questions about what qualifies you to speak on constitutional law matters over the cyber chat?
Well, this is the nature of social media. Of course, people always say that, but it is, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah,
luckily, there are many constitutional experts. So,
thank you for your time, Professor Pierre DeVos. There you have it, politicians.